Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Thank you for joining us at the Startup Grind today. To give you a brief introduction of our organization, we are world's largest independent startup community. We are in 200 cities across 85 countries. Mm-hmm. Our intention is to connect, educate, and inspire entrepreneurs. And we are so glad to have one of the founders of Compassionate Kozhikode with us today. And welcome to Startup Grind.
Thank you for having me here.
So, before we start about the Compassionate Kozhikode project, we need to know a bit about your previous academic and professional background, because that's usually the first question.
Well, basically, I'm a law graduate. I did my law in University of Kerala. After that, I got into Indian Audit and Account Service, and then into IAS. I'm of the 2007 batch. I've been in Kerala cadre for last 9 years. Holding various posts. I started off in Calicut as an assistant collector and a trainee here, and then sub-collector Manandavadi, that's in Wayanad. Then various positions in Trivandrum.
So could you please tell us about the Compassionate Kozhikode project? It has been awarded one of the top 50 inspirational global projects. It also got the award for social media for empowerment from the Digital Empowerment Forum in India. How did this Compassionate Kozhikode project happen? Could you please walk us through this project?
Well, it was not entirely planned. It just unfolded. It all started off with my visit in the early days of my collectorship in Calicut, when I visited the mental health center there at Kudravattam. It was a casual visit, but very disturbing visit. After seeing the condition there, after personally observing the plight of the people there, we say that we are a very highly evolved society, 100% literate, education, health, all the indices are on the higher side. And yet, in Kerala, in Kozhikode, a very affluent city, you have a hospital where basic requirements are not met. The patients are kept in very pathetic conditions. That was a very disturbing day as far as I was concerned. And I talked to the superintendent there and asked him what could be done. So he had a wish list. He pulled out a list of so many small things which probably would make the life of these people slightly better. Very, very silly things. Could be a bucket or a mug or pillow or cot, or basic amenities inside the hospital. Now, one would wonder why these things were not procured. That, for understanding that, you need to work in government. You'll understand there is a procedure for that. There is a procedure, and then there's allotment. There is a whole lot of things associated with these kind of expenditure, especially the recurring expenditures. So what I felt was, we need to make a difference then, there, at that point of time. Because it's the lives of people there. It's the quality of life of the people there. Yeah, I can report this, seek further funds, push for it. There is a way of doing it. But then, by the time these things get done, probably the people who would benefit will not be there. Yeah. So you need to make that difference in their lives at least one day before that, isn't it? At least a few moments earlier, if possible now. So that was the whole idea, and quite instinctively I posted this on my official Facebook page, the wish list that was provided by the superintendent of the hospital, and called out for help. And I was pleasantly surprised that in a matter of less than 2 weeks, we could get all the requirements, costing quite a few lakhs of rupees. Now that showed something, that if you tap the potential, it's there out there. And it also showed the power of social media. One thing we were very particular was that we wouldn't ask for money. We will only ask for the material to be procured and supplied there. See, asking for money and getting money and then making the procurement, that again brings me back to the similar situation. I mean, if I procure, I'll have to go through a government procurement system, which again furthers the delay. Here, again, I'll have to go through L1 and all this stuff. here you have the option of someone making the contribution in kind. The only condition which we kept was there won't be any photography and, you know, exhibition of this so-called charity. So two things which we discovered, our team, all the, you know, people around me, the staff, the people, well-wishers of the hospital, whoever were them, all of us decided that, okay, this seems to be a very interesting model. Mm-hmm. You diagnose the requirement, you understood what is required. Now, instead of waiting for manna to come from the heaven, let us try to solve it then and there, through collective partnership, through community partnership. And if required, call out for the, you know, help. This was further institutionalized into a platform called Compassionate Kozhikode. If you visit the website compassionatekozhikode.in, you'll find that this has evolved and developed into a platform where requirements are placed of all major government institutions in the social sector. It could be the orphanage, it could be the, you know, home for the differently abled, intellectually challenged children, or the old age home, or the mental hospital, or the medical college. Now, all these institutions have lots of requirements for which the government is not able to do enough. And it's not the fault of the government, it's not anyone's fault. There are institutional issues, there are structural problems which need to be corrected. Probably it was not corrected at one point of time, probably there could be hundreds of reasons of such a condition. But then, we need to find a solution, isn't it? There's no point debating about it. While we, on the one side, try to correct these structural problems, we are writing, we are taking up the issues. Those things are happening on one side, but it will take time. In the meantime, we need to find a solution now. For instance, you need a therapist, you need a specialist in a particular hospital. You don't have a post for that, but you have the equipment. Now, equipments are lying idle. What can you do? You need a psychotherapist. That post is not there. What do you do? You can't just say that I have written to the government, I am waiting for the post to be created. Once the post is created, once the, you know, recruitment happens, then we will get. Till then, what do we do? So that's where volunteerism was introduced. So we asked for volunteers to join us. We have got volunteers ranging from, you know, college students to highly, you know, professional people who would be highly paid outside in the, you know, private sector. So all of them have been collaborating with us. Basically, Compassionate Kozhikode has evolved itself into a platform where we place the requirements, people come and try to help us. Collectively, it's a society, it's a community itself trying to take care of the requirements. Basically, that is Compassionate Kozhikode.
So even globally, we are seeing this trend in the startup scene moving towards civic techs, using technology for doing public good by bringing citizens together using social media. So we have companies like OpenGovern, which is working with the government data, for example, budgets, to make sure that the money is going to the right projects. In India, we have interesting companies like Social Cops, which is accessing, analyzing and visualizing data, helping governments to make the right decisions. Even in Kerala, a lot of startups are trying to work with the government. So as someone from the government, what is the idea that you have right now about the openness towards innovation and digital engagement that government is embracing?
Well, there's a lot of scope for that. But whenever you think about engagement with the government, I think we need to have clarity. How to engage? That is a crucial question. Generally, in the private sector, you come up with an innovation, you have that innovation in your hand, that is good enough, you know, that's money. An idea is worth, you know, millions. So you just go out, find a partner, you do business and you make money. It's as simple as that. In the government sector, when you come up with an idea, when you approach government with an idea, usually the problem with government is with the procurement system itself. So government, what would it do? It would look for L1, or it would look for a process, at least a semblance of process, at least through which a selection has been made. How did I select you? That would be the fundamental question. Did I favor you?
You have, in spite of all the political appointments.
Yeah, I mean, those are things that have been provided for. Political appointments are provided for, but that's the spoiled system. That's everywhere. Even in the US, you have that. But, you know, when you procure services or procure a partner in some sort of business, engagement, whatever be it, you need to go through a process in government. That's a good thing, that's also a bad thing. Especially when you have a unique idea, when you have something new, something brilliant, how do I go through a procurement process? So these are fundamental issues. That's where the government institutions, the arms, the PSUs could be of some use. Most innovators try to approach the government through these PSUs, the corporate arms which the government itself has created to do business. Again, this depends. I mean, sometimes you could work out Swiss challenges. There are various ways of engaging. In the procurement system of government actually needs to improve as well, get updated. It should be open to more innovation and unique solutions. The general manner in which government does business is doing ordinary business, ordinary in the sense predictable business. You have somebody giving a particular kind of work, say a contracting business. There will be n number of people who will be providing similar services. Then the government would select someone from this group through a process. It's fairly simple. But if you have a brilliant idea and you are coming out with that, you are a lone person, it's unique. How do I create a selection procedure for you? If I create a selection procedure for you, your idea would be out. There will be 100 people copying that.
Yes.
It's a chicken and egg issue. But there is a solution for this as well. It's not impossible. But the problem is you need people in the government also to be receptive to such ideas. One nice way to make this happen is a bit of white labeling actually. A bit of white labeling helps engagement with the government because the government will not have a problem engaging with the private sector entrepreneur if there is no financials involved. At the same time, it could be of some larger public good. In compassionate code projects, we have many such collaborations. We have private sector entities collaborating with us, a good number of them. On various scales, on various initiatives, where money is not involved, and our fundamental principle, our theory itself is that we will not be taking money and we will not be allowing photography. So, advertisement aspect is also not there. So you would be wondering why should someone associate with us? But then there is enough reason for that. Even white labeling and engaging with the government at one level. Without any direct profit which you could perceive, there are larger advantages of that which the corporates who have engaged with us would clearly appreciate.
Talking about the collaborations, if you look at Compassionate Kozhikode, there are a lot of partners, be it Indian Institute of Management, be it Madhubhumi, a media company, design studio Papaya, I hope it's run by Ashik Abu and Rima, and Brainwash, a PR company, and Iram, lot of players on board. Could you please tell us about the relevance of partnership and also the value they bring on board for an initiative like Compassionate Kozhikode?
Most of our partners are on the creative side, people who have ideas. Most of the names which you took have their creative teams closely associated with us because we look at selling ideas, because socially selling ideas is very important. For instance, getting the community to participate in activities requires the right way of pitching the idea. For instance, we have this government scheme of cleaning up water bodies. You have the some sort of allocation from the government, limited to 50,000 or something, so you cannot actually spend that directly on cleaning up the water body. You can only spend it on refreshments. Okay. Now, if I send out an ad saying that, or a press release saying that, guys, please come over. I'll be providing you refreshments. Please come and associate with us for cleaning up the pond, water body, whatever. It looks so uninteresting and dry. The way to bring people in is just by saying, guys, why don't you join us for cleaning this particular pond on this Sunday? I'll buy you a biryani. It's the one and the same thing, isn't it?
Yes.
But this is, say, marketing or say, selling the idea in a better way. So who says that the government projects have to be sold in a very dry manner? It can be sold, it can be told to the public in a very interesting and refreshing manner so that they also find interest. Now, just by taking up this form of social selling, we could clear up more than 70 ponds in that district. The result of which we are now getting, like now after the rains, we are finding that these ponds are all swelled up and it's looking good. So we need partners from ordinary people onwards to corporates. What's important is what do they gain out of it and what do we gain? Now when these creative teams associate with us, it's a two-way traffic. It's not that they sell us the ideas and we just take it. We also give ideas. Creative discussions, you would appreciate it. Anyone who is into creativity, they will understand that these discussions are very refreshing for all the people involved. So it's not a one-way traffic. They also benefit. And other corporates who visibly don't look like, on the surface they don't look like benefiting anything, but all of them have a compassionate side to them. All of them have the CSR aspect. Now, there are so many ways of associating with government whereby they spend their CSR money. At the same time, in the long run, their business also benefits. It may not be direct advertisement, but we actively encourage corporates to take up advertisement of a different nature. For instance, we have a program coming up for the beach. The beach side, we will be cleaning up and we will be dividing it into zones for various corporates to take up the maintenance.
Is that some kind of competition?
Yeah, we would be having a competition between the zones, and one would expect that these particular corporates would be putting up all their advertisement there. No, we won't be allowing any advertisement. Without any advertisement, without any publicity of that kind, we are sure that those particular corporate groups would be maintaining that slot, that zone. We have identified six such companies who have already agreed to do that. Already they have started the cleaning process. Every month, collectively, they are spending 1 to 2 lakhs already for the last 2-3 months. Now, cleaning is just a routine thing. Now we are going to take it to the next level by putting up facilities there, like say open air gym or whatever. The various themes have been identified by various partners. Now, this has been going on. The homework has been going on in the background. They have already started this cleaning up. They have engaged an agency to do the cleaning, and every month they are already incurring expense more than 1 to 2 lakh. Without putting up any advertisement.
But in spite of all this, we as a society and also from the government, we see a bit of reluctance in terms of establishing partnerships with private companies. And where do you think, according to you, we should draw a line for the private partnership?
I think, there is fear from both sides. Okay, the private sector, I have lots of friends in the private sector, most of them fear engaging with the government itself because they feel that it's a nuisance. And most of them have had pretty bad experiences due to various reasons. The fault could lie on either side. And from the government side, engagement is feared because of the fact that many officials fear criticism. Why should someone be seen associating with a particular company? Is there some hanky-panky? What is he going to gain? Those kind of nonsense, I call it nonsense. Why should you fear engaging with a citizen? Your governance is for citizens. Now, an ordinary man, he could be a poor man, he could be a rich man, he could be a middle class man, he could also be a corporate entity. An entity is also a citizen. Now, these are all people or entities with which you have to engage. Governance is for them. You don't have to fear them. But then the fact is that over the years, our society and particularly media has played a bit of a negative role in this. Some private entity making profit is seen as a sin. How could they make profit? It's too bad. Yeah. How could the government help someone make profit? That's also worth recollecting that you have this Prevention of Corruption Act. Now, in that act, it is said that some private entity getting something out of the way and all that stuff, that is a crime. An official helping, that is crime. Also, helping someone make pecuniary benefit itself is crime.
But we still need taxes on those people.
Yeah. So this is a mentality that has to change. But I'm sure, with liberalization, with people understanding how to do business and the realities are there staring at you, you need to move ahead in life. You have to change your perception, you have to change your thought process, without which we'll not be able to survive. And I think things will change. The old school is still there. I'm very much aware of that. The old school is very much there. The old school would not appreciate community partnership in governance. They feel that governance is a top-down stuff which has to be done by officials. How could you seek help of someone? Many people would of the old school, some bureaucrats themselves, I'm quite aware of that. Some people clearly criticize this. They say that you need not seek help from outsiders. It is the job of the government, so you should not seek help. That's a fundamental problem. You are seeing people as outsiders. They are also part of governance. You can't really differentiate the general public from governance. They are not enemies, they are not aliens. Governance is for them, and it is taxpayers' money that is coming through the government. Now, if someone is willingly trying to support us from outside without seeking any publicity, without getting into our procurement process, he or she is directly helping the most needy in the system. How can you actually object to that? But there are people who would even object to that. That's the reality. We need to face that and go ahead.
You also run a lot of interesting programs like the internship program, where you work with a lot of young professionals in the governance process. Could you please tell us about your experience working with young people?
Yeah, we started running this district collectors internship program primarily because we wanted youngsters to get involved in governance, and secondly because we wanted the service of these youngsters and we wanted to pick the brains of these chaps, which was very interesting. We ran that in partnership with IIM, and we got very good interns from IRMA, from IIM, from IIT, from various other engineering colleges, medical colleges, dental colleges, law college, and quite a few arts and science colleges as well. All of them proved to be very, very enthusiastic, very, very interesting youngsters. But our internship is pretty tough. We have not taken all the applicants, first of all. We gave a decent grilling and only then we took them, and not all of them could complete the internship also, because this internship is totally unpaid, first of all.
Even so, UN internships are unpaid.
Yeah, that's true. I didn't know that when I started off this, but later on when I did visit the UN University, I came to know that they are also running an unpaid
I did an unpaid internship at UN, and Lord, it was so expensive.
At least Kozhikode is not that expensive.
Yeah.
So if you get admission to a UN internship and a district collector's internship program in Kozhikode, you have to choose the Kozhikode.
Oh, perfect.
So, we don't spoon feed them also.
Yeah.
And the DCIP program, how that's run is like, it's a absolute freedom that's given to these students. And the projects, whichever they work on, they will see it implemented. So it's serious stuff. It's not like preparing a paper project and getting away with it. No, these are all live running projects. Sometimes the projects will start running before they complete the paperwork. That's the kind of speed at which we are trying to function. So it's interesting that way. By the time they start the project, midway through the paperwork, they'll see the project running. So midway then they'll have to change course and make it into an evaluation kind of stuff also. So that way it's very interesting. The IRMA group did wonderful job. They did the back end for the website, for instance, for the website, and also the back end logistics for Compassionate Kozhikode project. So most of them did excellent work, and that's one of its kind, I'll say, because Usually you are outside the government and you keep complaining, nothing's happening. Why doesn't the government do this? Why don't they do this? And all that we keep cribbing. But here what we are saying is, why don't you come in, make a difference? You said you want to do that, why don't you come and do this? So we're giving an opportunity. And we have all the segments, all the, you know, whatever is available in the district, we offer it on a platter. Our primary focus always remains on the most vulnerable sections, the children's home and old age home, and all those institutions are our prime priority. But that doesn't mean that we don't look at other sections. Like, we do allow the interns to take up projects on transportation, for instance, or any other interesting, road maintenance. Any of these projects are also welcome. So it has been going fine. We had a couple of batches, and it's not a closed internship. It's a running internship. So sometimes the students, they, especially those who come from foreign universities, they might find a different slot convenient for them. So that's also possible. So it's a very flexible internship that way, but it's a very tough internship if you look at it the other way, because not everyone completes it successfully.
Have you worked with startups yet for solving some particular issue that you were facing in the government?
There are lots of companies, by and large you could term them as startups, who have collaborated with us on the creative side and also on the technology side, especially with apps and all, right, designing these apps and all. They have collaborated with us. A couple of our solutions are supplied by them.
And so there's this interesting project called Hey Auto in Compassionate Kurikord. Did it take off well, like the Uber?
Yeah, that's something quite similar to Uber. But the auto segment is different. Not everyone calls an auto on phone. Auto is usually just on the road, you show your hand and you get into the auto. But now we are upgrading that into a app for the taxis, which will, I believe, offer tough competition to the existing Uber or Ola type companies. That is in process. So that it's the same company, the same startup is providing the back end for that also. So there we did white labeling basically. It's a free app which they have provided for us. It's a win-win thing. There's a larger story behind it. So
one of the most important criticisms that you face on your crowdsourcing project is that a lot of qualified professionals will be left behind, otherwise they would have got into the government system. But your focus seemed to be very much on getting things done. So how do we find the common ground?
See, getting things done doesn't kill anyone's opportunity. In government, the jobs are all very clearly designated. What are the posts? How many posts have been created? What job will you get? How many jobs have been notified by the PSC? The recruitment is always done through PSC. It will take its own sweet time. That's given. You can't touch that. Despite that, things don't get done. And there'll be some places where the posts are not created, and the government may not be able to create the posts in the near future. You should understand governance to understand how stupid such criticisms are actually, because unless you understand how governance is run, how government runs, how recruitment happens, what is the lag, and there is a lag period for every recruitment. Suppose there is a vacancy that arises today, in government you have to get it notified, then it goes to the PSC, then there will be a PSC list that will be provided, and it will take a couple of years at least. So you can't wait for that.
Not at all related, right?
It's not at all related. That's a separate stream happening somewhere else. Here we are getting things done. Now people who don't understand head or tail of this will think that, oh my God, someone is volunteering and spoiling the chance of someone else getting there. That doesn't affect at all. The worst part is that there are people in the government who probably will not be doing work also.
Yeah.
They are also...
They'll get away with it.
They'll get away with it. They will anyway get away with it. You can't really, put the pistol on their heads and make them work. That's a reality everywhere. like it's like 2 to 5% work the 90% of the job. I mean, that's the way it works in every institution, not even in the government sector, even in private sector, I believe. Because I've seen far more inefficient private sector companies than the government. So there's no point blaming the government that way. The sum and summary is just this, that you need things done, be it private or government, you need things to be done, especially those kind of things that affect the lives of people.
Yeah.
And especially those people who are most miserable and most vulnerable, they need to be taken care of. You can't put them in the lurch and say that let's wait for someone to get into the job, his job is more important, till the job is secured I'll ensure that this fellow suffers. That's not my understanding of administration. That's not the way governance should work.
Recently, the Wired magazine ran an article on how crowdfunding for public is evil. And they did come up with some valid points. But do you personally think that a group of well-intended citizens coming together and solving the issues which should have been primarily solved by the government in the long run would make the government inefficient or in fact irrelevant? Do you think that is a possibility?
It is quite possible, but then we need to understand the model of compassionate code code here. Here it is government itself, I mean the district administration itself, that is finding different sources of solutions. You know, the government is not abdicating, this is the government, but the government is only trying better tricks to get things done.
Yeah.
Isn't it? Instead, if you leave it completely to the citizens, I do agree. The government might even become irrelevant. But it should be at the leadership level of the government itself that things should be solved, because only the government, someone who is inside the government, will have a clear idea of what solutions are coming from the government side. For instance, in the children's home, for instance, if you need certain things to be procured for the kids, I should be able to clearly say whether a parallel procurement is happening on the government side. I should also be able to ensure that there is no duplication. It shouldn't be like procurement has happened from the crowdsourcing aspect, it has come here and the particular officer there, he shows this into the account and says that he has bought it. That shouldn't happen. So there should be an active authority, government level intervention to regulate this. You can't have a free for all. That won't be good for the government or governance or democracy. But the argument that crowdsourcing would otherwise make an issue for the government, I don't believe in that, because crowdsourcing of effort, crowdsourcing of resources, not necessarily money, but crowdsourcing of resources, I prefer that in kind, is an alternate source of income for the government in that sense.
Yeah.
It's a kind of voluntary taxation,
yeah,
isn't it? Why should you always depend on compulsory taxation? You can have this kind of income as well, which is good for the government, because you are saving the compulsory taxed money, you are paying the taxpayers' money, isn't it? You are saving it. You can use it for other priority works as well. If someone is willing to provide for this, well and good, let's use it.
Also, you have said in a lot of your previous interviews that you do not have any idea to replicate or sustain compassionate Kori Code. Would you think that would be a little selfish to, for a project like compassionate Kori Code to just go off like that? What are your future plans with that?
Well, I didn't say that it should dissipate and...
No, yeah, you said you had no intention to
what
sustain
I said,
it.
See, when someone asked me,
yeah,
after you go own this compassionate code project, just disappear and all that stuff, it's in such a context that I say that I really don't bother.
Yeah.
In the sense, I don't think compassionate code is a project that should be put in a showcase and kept like that to show, see, I have started this project, please see this, this is a wonderful project. This is not a memorabilia. It's not a like Ashoka Stambha you are putting up somewhere and saying that this is in memoriam. No, the intention of the project is to spread compassion,
yeah,
in amongst all the partners, all the stakeholders, including officials, including me. All of us have changed coming through this project, while running this project, we have all had experiences that has transformed all of us, including me. I keep saying that. Now, what's the purpose of this? The purpose of this is to show that there is a platform. It's possible that on a platform, if you place the diagnosis, there are people who are willing to supply the medicine. Things will be, it's basically matchmaking which we are doing. And this is a sustainable model, I believe. We are just showing that this is possible. Now, there could be better ways of doing this also. Now, why should I pull it down? There could be better ways, there could be better networking, there could be better technology, there could be better names also. So, compassionate Kozhikode is not the starting point and the ending point. Compassion is. Compassion is something which needs to spread. That should last. That should last amongst all the stakeholders, all the partners, all the officials, everyone included. Not necessarily compassionate Kozhikode. That is really irrelevant.
I've worked with the government on a couple of projects, and what I have noticed all the time is that they don't understand proposals, especially if it involves technology, but they always understand prototypes. And I believe compassionate Kozhikode is a wonderful working prototype, and with a bit of political will, it could become a compassionate Kerala, or by another name, or compassionate India. Do you think there's a possibility for that?
Very much, because this is a very simple model.
Yeah.
Very simple. You are just putting up the requirement, and you are, getting the people to register and make the delivery. This could have become a huge hit and a bigger driving force if I had provided for payment.
Yeah.
That was a conscious decision not to provide for payment, because there are hundreds of requests every day asking for account numbers.
Yeah.
I want to give this, I want to provide such and such that has been asked for in the website. I would like to donate. Please tell me the account number, I would like to transfer the money. That's the usual request, which we say no, because transferring money is a very easy thing, and we don't want people to get away so easily.
Yeah.
They should come here, they should become part of the project. They should, if possible, deliver these things by hand and get involved. That is how you, get that exposure and your, bit of compassion gets ignited. This is not a, very dry fundraising kind of stuff. This is about people, this is about individuals, this is about human beings. We are not interested in the volumes. We are interested in the quality of the change that, that could happen in people. So, replication is very easy, and people are more interested in replication if there is that money transfer involved. Everyone says, well, why don't we introduce that? If someone is really interested in replicating this model, I would be very happy. There are people from various NGOs who have tried to get this running in other states, for instance. Especially the Operation Soleimani aspect, which is a fairly simple model again. There again, whenever it's being replicated elsewhere, what I felt was certain core principles get compromised. Things like dignity, for instance. Dignity is something which we clearly and very strongly hold close to our heart. Dignity of the beneficiary, so-called beneficiary, should be respected.
Yeah.
His identity should not be revealed. Someone coming and having food, free food, free food, and you take his photograph and give publicity for fundraising. Those are the things which we are strongly against. We have already had more than 20,000 people who have taken food under the Operation Soleimani scheme. Not a single person has been photographed. And we have so far had no fund crunch. That's enough. We are just going by small fund, the Soleimani boxes that are maintained by the Hotel and Restaurant Association people. That's good enough for us. In fact, the very first week after we launched this Operation Soleimani, we had an offer from a major industrialist in the Gulf. He wanted to offer 1 crore from his side and 25 lakhs from his employees. So 1.25 crore was the offer, which we refused.
Decided to decline.
Yeah. We, with a lot of respect and love, we told no. We don't want that. because we didn't want this to become a benevolence program,
yeah.
And this shouldn't become something at the disposal of some rich big man. He is giving food to the poor people of Kozhikode. No, that's not the way it should be perceived. It should be seen as a community project. We are feeding ourselves. When I have money, I'll put it into the box. When I don't have money, I'll take a coupon. So it's free for anyone. And we don't pass judgments. Someone who comes and asks for a coupon, we don't judge him. We don't ask him questions. How long have you been hungry? Can you get a gazetted officer to sign and prove that you are hungry? Those things are not there. So something that runs on compassion and faith and trust.
Yeah.
So that runs. What I was saying is replicability is easy. It's all replicable, I believe. But we feel our team feels a bit uncomfortable when the philosophy behind it gets diluted.
Yeah.
Dignity is very crucial, and not asking for money is very crucial. Not going in for photography is very crucial. Now these aspects are very important as far as we are concerned, and that's the one reason why you don't see anything about Compassion Kozhikode in the media. You'll not find anything. You'll not find a single story about a beneficiary under Compassion Kozhikode, even though we have already managed to provide so many things. I mean, we don't like to even list out the things which we have done, but then it's a fact that more than 20,000 people have had meals under Soleimani project. More than 200 to 250 students have got a scholarship under this matchmaking system which we have evolved. But all these things, equipments that have been provided to these institutions, all these things are not to be discussed, nor publicized, nor any of these donations or any of these partnerships. You will not find a photograph taken, you will not find anything being splashed anywhere. So that's the model which we believe in, and it's sustaining. Maybe if you give a bit more of a publicity for this, you will find more people doing it, but you end up compromising on the core values. So let it be small, let it be beautiful, let it not be even be replicated, fine, we are okay with it.
So is there any dream project that you want to work on? Governance using technology and social media, other than the projects that's already in the Compassionate Kozhikode.
Well,
something that you always wanted to do.
No, nothing of that kind. I don't dream of those big things. In fact, all these things, whatever has been done, also have not been really dreamt or really planned. These are things that have come naturally, and I think there'll be something bigger waiting for everyone. You just need to go naturally. Maybe your experience, your people around you. There are so many nice people around you with wonderful ideas. You just need to keep your eyes and ears open to listen to them, take those ideas, discuss with more people, get it implemented. There'll be somebody waiting there somewhere with more wonderful ideas for you.
Thank you so much, Phil.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.